Chess was one of the most innovative record labels of all time. Throughout the 1950s and 60s, Chess was at the cutting edge of black music, releasing blues, rock and roll, and soul masterpieces.
When you look at Chess Records, boy, is that some textbook.
We are the bomb with Chess Records.
Roll over, Beethoven, I gotta hear it again today.
Chess artists like Chuck Berry, Muddy Waters, and Bo Diddley changed the landscape of popular music on both sides of the Atlantic.
Amazing harmonica solos, amazing guitars, tones.
What came out was just something that was
amazing lyrics, amazing vocals.
What a massive impact it had on the artists of the 60s who went on to have kind of changed the world.
The label was the result of an unlikely marriage between black musicians and two white Jewish entrepreneurs, Phil and Leonard Chess, at a time when America was deeply divided by race.
You had a combination of a brash dude like Leonard Chess, and you had a guy like Muddy Waters who were bold, and together they had a combination that said, hey, let's go get it.
And this big musical adventure took place in Chicago, the Windy City.
It whistles, it talks, it moans, it groans, and all the while it's doing those things, it's blowing that air.
In the first half of the 20th century, migrants, both black and white, blew into Chicago, attracted to its more liberal atmosphere and the chance to change their lives. Amongst these hundreds of thousands of immigrants included Muddy Waters from Mississippi and Leonard Chess from Poland.
It was a typical immigrant story. My family came from a small town in Poland. Like all immigrants, they came to America to make money, and it was a better life.
Black Americans also moved to Chicago, fleeing the racism of the southern states.
The whole feel of that era was one of a rush to freedom, at least a rush to less oppression.
The job opportunities were there. If you worked at the post office in Chicago at that time, you was big doo-doo.
Well, I ain't from Chicago, I'm from a little town. No, I ain't.
To the black migrants moving up from the south, Chicago was an exciting new world.
It was a booming city, a lot of action. You went into a club, everybody was from either Tennessee, Mississippi, Georgia, Texas, or New Orleans. And the common ground was it was from the South, and they loved the blues.
Let's go to Chicago, because you can start to make real money there. Of course, what you didn't realize was that you were going to work in some very, very hard circumstances. But look at those clubs. I mean, the opportunity to sort of, you know, down tools and play.
In 1945, right at the end of World War II, Leonard Chess, a 28-year-old Jewish entrepreneur, was looking for business opportunities and spotted one within this black Chicago world.
He opened this liquor store in a rough black ghetto neighborhood, and that's where he got his first inkling of black people loving to buy alcohol at the party, and that's where he saw the next step.
Leonard's next business move was to open a bar with live music, the Macomba Lounge, in 1947.
A black nightclub, a hangout for jazz musicians, for prostitutes, pimps, drug dealers.
I'm going fishing, baby.
Marshall Chess remembers his father, Leonard, taking him to the Macomba Lounge when he was just 5 years old.
There were gunshots, and my father threw me across the bar to my uncle, who laid on top of me on the floor on these wooden slats, you know, with stale alcohol and old cigarette smell.
Out juicing all night, you come home stewed.
Leonard was a gambling man. He regularly moved within Chicago's Jewish poker circles. and this is where he met businesswoman Evelyn Aaron. In 1947, Evelyn invited Leonard to join her new record label, Aristocrat. It was here this white Polish salesman met a 31-year-old black musician from Mississippi, Muddy Waters. Their friendship would shape the rest of their lives and play a key part in the growth of Chess Records.
They just met each other at the right time, the beginning of both of their moves toward a better life, and both driven, and both leaders. I mean, I think the Muddy once told me that my father was one of the first white men that he ever really had a true friendship with. That was something my father felt very comfortable about, his black people. I used to tease him and say, you're more comfortable around blacks than whites. He says, you know, in some ways you're right, you know.
In Chicago in the late 1940s, the acoustic country blues of the black southern migrant was starting to change. To compete with the sounds of the big city, the musicians were embracing amplifiers and electric guitars, transforming the blues into a tougher, louder urban blast.
It just became a practical reality that, you know, once you get into a bar, you know, a club, became hard to hear the band, you know, so they just had to plug in.
You got a lot of people in a small space, and people are celebrating it loud, and they want to get it popping.
Leonard's new friend, Muddy Waters, was at the forefront of this new emerging urban blues style. In 1948, when he was making his very first recordings for Aristocrat Records, Muddy made a crucial breakthrough in the birth of electric blues in Chicago.
There had been recordings with electric guitar before, but it tended to be an adjunct. I can't be satisfied. It was like, you know, wow. the guitar was up there with the voice. It was a lot of what the record is about, is that...
He's playing it just like he would originally played it on acoustic, but now he's got that exciting element of the electric guitar. So this is country blues that's come to town.
There were guitarists who could play really well acoustic, but they couldn't make that transition. It just didn't work on electric for them. But Muddy managed to come up with this style that really crystallized this whole thing, which made it his character for him and what he was trying to project. If it's done in 1948, it's even more astonishing.
That sort of was like perked up the ears of a lot of kids around the country. Says, what is that?
Well, I'm gone away to leave. Won't be back no more.
In 1949, when Evelyn Aaron left Aristocrat, Leonard and his brother Phil took a gamble and bought the label outright. 1 year later, the brothers gambled again, relaunching Aristocrat as Chess Records.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Leonard and Phil, opposites. A very typical two-brother situation. My Uncle Phil, laid back, smoking those big cigars. My father, the older brother, driven, possessed. Two different personalities, and they knew it.
Well, I wish...
Leonard had the initiative. Leonard was the one who had the sharper vision. Phil helped him execute it. And again, I think that the enterprise probably wouldn't have been the same if it had just been Leonard by himself with trusted hired help. The fact that it was Leonard and Phil made it special.
Leonard and Phil released the first blues hit on their new Chess label in 1950. Rolling Stone by Muddy Waters.
I went to...
It was hitting everywhere. It was all over Chicago, Rolling Stone.
Muddy Waters says it. He really made Chess, and Chess really made him. And the very early success of Muddy Waters really inspired both my uncle and Muddy Waters.
I don't want you to be no slave.
Although the recording of Rolling Stone was just electric guitar and bass, Muddy's live club band was larger, and he was keen to bring them into the recording studio. At first, the Chess brothers were reluctant to break the successful formula. They eventually relented and allowed Muddy to record his club band on masterpieces like I Just Want to Make Love to You.
And that began the archetype of what the rock and roll band would become, you know. The bass, the guitar, keyboard, you know, drums. That sort of configuration was pretty much created by the Muddy Waters band.
When it came down to Muddy Waters putting together a band, that total sound is really what got the crowd moving and rocking.
He sounds some kind of like a lion, you know, you can imagine with a big mane and he'd somehow sound like that. I just want to make
love to you. You had a combination of Muddy Waters who were bold, and you had a brash dude like Leonard Chess. And together they had a combination that said, hey, let's go get it.
The promotion that Leonard Chess gave Muddy Waters allowed him to play at bigger black venues in Chicago. One of the city's most famous disc jockeys, Herb Kent, witnessed Muddy's growing popularity.
In all the areas that we were playing, I Just Want to Make Love to You. And people came out and they were dancing and doing the hoochie coochie. I will never forget that. I began to really understand that at that point, Chicago was a blues town.
Muddy's band included harmonica player and blues bad boy Little Walter. In 1952, at the end of a recording session for Chess, Muddy allowed Little Walter to cut an instrumental called Duke. From then on, it became essential for Chicago blues bands to include an amplified harmonica in their lineup.
He was sort of the Eric Clapton or, you know, Jeff Beck, the job they would serve in the Yardbirds. You know, Little Walter was the Flash. You know, he did the killer solos, you know.
Duke was a masterpiece. It was just a great creative piece of work that he came up with.
But Leonard Chess was unsure of when to release Little Walter's Duke. A couple of months after the recording, Leonard played the song in the office. As he turned up the volume, Leonard watched the women outside on the street start to dance.
It was an immediate sign to my father and everyone, rush this out, you know? He always used to like to watch the response of his audience.
After the success of Duke, Little Walter went solo, recording a number of blues hits for Chess that sometimes even outsold Muddy's own releases for the label. One of them was called Boom Boom, Out Go the Lights.
No kidding, I'm ready to fight. I've been looking for my baby all night. If I get her in my sight, boom, boom, out go the light.
He was sort of that archetype rock and roller, you know. He was the one getting in fights, and obviously a song from the heart. You know what I mean? This is what was going on in his life. You'd have no problem believing that, you know.
When I first heard that record, I was like, I shook my head. I said, man, I can't believe it. It's like he's really talking about if his woman goes out for the night, you know, he find her, you know, whatever, he might forgive her, but boom, boom, I'ma knock her out. And I was like, whoa.
Like hip-hop, early electric blues reflected the mood of the black ghetto of the neighborhood, the problems. There weren't psychiatrists or psychologists for black people.
It showed you exactly the time and the period of what was acceptable, which is crazy. But also it showed you how crazy Lil Walter was.
Boom, boom, out go the light.
As the music developed in Chicago, Leonard worked night and day conducting huge sweeping tours of the southern states, where he charmed local DJs, distributors, and retailers. This was essential to the label's commercial growth, and the South became Chess's biggest market outside of Chicago.
The United States still had legally sanctioned segregation, so when Leonard went down south, he was a white man. He could indeed go any place he wanted. He didn't have to determine, can I stay in this hotel? Can I get gas at this station? Do I have to get my food from the back at this restaurant if they will even serve me?
Leonard, like other Jewish immigrants in the States, had experienced racial prejudice and empathized with the plight of black Americans.
I think they had a real soft spot for black people who were feeling the same thing as they felt. They knew how it felt, but they knew they had the edge by being white.
It was Leonard, the white businessman, who searched for new black musical talent during these trips. Once, when visiting Chess distributor and friend Stan Lewis in Louisiana, Leonard came face to face with the racism of the South.
I called Leonard and I said, Leonard, I got a good blues singer by the name of Stickhorse Hammond. He was owned by the owner of the plantation. So we drove up this big mansion, and this man came out with his shotgun. And I said, sir, do you have a guy by the name of Stickhorse Hammond? And I says, I have a friend here, Leonard Chess, that wants to make a big store out of him. And he stuck a shotgun in my stomach. And he says, what do you want with my nigga? What you want with my nigga? You leave my nigga alone. And he was shoving that shotgun in my stomach. And Leonard said, come on, Stan, let's get out of here.
You ain't gonna worry my life anymore.
Despite the racism of the South, there were also good times during these mid-50s road trips. For Leonard's son Marshall, who sometimes accompanied him, they were an opportunity to bond with his workaholic father.
When I was 13, my father picked me up in Miami, Florida. We had gone for a three-week trip in some horribly cheap motel, and he took me with him back all the way up through Chicago, through the South. We get outside of Mobile, he says, you know, I'm falling asleep. And he says, you drive. I was going in my pants, you know, I was scared. Started driving between Mobile, Alabama and New Orleans. That was our next stop. And he actually started snoring. And I'll never forget, I woke him up because about an hour later, I ran into a field of locusts. I had to put the windscreen wipers on to get rid of the bugs that scared me. A little bit of insight into my father's personality and his relation to me was, he said, come on, I want to teach you how to shake hands, you know. And he gave me this really firm grip and he said, look me right in the eye. And he said, that's how you shake hands like a man, you know. And to this day, I look in people's eyes and shake hands as hard as I can.
Back in Chicago, Leonard kept busy producing Chess artists in the studio. Here, he believed that goading them often brought out their best performance. One exchange between himself and Sonny Boy Williamson revealed Leonard's provocative technique and his enjoyment of black American slang.
What's the name of it?
Little Village. A little village, motherfucker, a little
you
village.
A motherfucker thinking they're about a village, you son of a bitch. Nothing the song has got anything to do with a village.
Well, a small town.
What a village is.
Well, all right. You don't name them, Tyler. You name it after you got to get shit through with it, son of a bitch. You name what you want it. You name it your mammy if you want it.
Take one, roll it.
By the mid-1950s, the label's roster already included blues innovators like Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, Sonny Boy Williamson, and Little Walter. These were the glory days of Chess Electric Blues.
The whole culture exploded a lot like hip-hop. Fashion was affected. The way people dressed, the cars they drove was affected. You better
believe it. So when they had the punk movement over here, they hit on something and they just all went at it.
There was a time I would come down to the studio and I would stand there and look out the big window and the Cadillacs would drive up. One, Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf, all of them would drive up and park their cars in front of the studio. It'd be five or six different colors, but all big Cadillacs.
There was this short period of years where the electric blues ruled, man. We had hit after hit.
Essential to Chess's success in the mid-1950s was arranger and songwriting genius Willie Dixon, who composed many of the label's most memorable blues hits. One of these was 1954's Hoochie Coochie Man, written for Muddy Waters.
It's just the sheer attitude. What would you give just to have been, you know, a fly on the wall in that studio? It's just be coming at you, the force of it. Yeah.
It was a track that epitomized the Chess electric blues era.
The gypsy woman told my mother before I was born, you got a boy child coming, gonna be a son of a gun. He gonna make pretty women jump and shout. Then the world wanna know what this all about, but you know I'm here.
This is adult music. Don't mix this up with kids. We doing this for grown folks who work, who looking to have a good time out.
What could be more sexual than the rooster, you know, kicking up to the woman, I'm your hoochie coochie man.
It has so much power to it, and yet they're taking their time. It's just, it's not a fast moving tune, but it's just tough and grinding away, and can't be denied.
Well, you know, we are the hoochie coochie boys. The whole United States know we here.
I owe such a debt to as a kid, as a teenager, listening to that music and just really being, you know, shaken to the core by it.
The roster of Chess artists and the blues riffs they created would later have a huge influence on 1960s and 70s rock acts like the Rolling Stones and Led Zeppelin.
Those endless repeated things, they become part of the language of blues, blues rock, jazz rock, rock.
In the mid-50s, these Chess blues artists were existing under the white radar and being enjoyed almost exclusively by a core black American audience.
It is a misconception, I think, particularly after the fact, that songs we now think of as great blues hits, the sales were not that great.
Chess blues acts like Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf were making their money not through record sales, but live shows, which their recordings helped promote.
It wasn't, let's make some artistic Library of Congress masterpieces. Let's make a hit, baby, so we can make some money this weekend. That's the real story.
Although Leonard and Phil weren't making large profits in 1954, they were doing okay. But in the following year, things changed rapidly when white American teenagers with cash to spend caught on to black music. In 1955, white American teenagers flocked to the movie Blackboard Jungle. Crucially, the film featured Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock, which gave many of these white youngsters their very first taste of rock and roll. In the same year, two black musicians, Bo Diddley and Chuck Berry, arrived at Chess with a brand new sound and a brand new energy. Leonard Chess was now armed with just the right artists to target this huge, lucrative white teenage market.
odd new sort of species sprang up that was in between adolescents and adults, you know, that had never existed before on the planet. And products had to be created for this new market, for this new species.
Bo Diddley's Roadrunner was exactly the type of fun, accessible product that would appeal to this new audience. Bo's family had moved from Mississippi to Chicago when he was six. By the early 1950s, Bo was in his 20s and a part-time musician in this city.
He did construction work. Spare time, he would play the guitar and sing. So he wasn't one of those guys out to try to be a star.
Bo was a guy with a big sense of humor. He built his own guitars. Those guitars looked like a box, a big box. I went over to his house one day and he had a basement full of amplifier parts and all scattered all over the place where he would try to make his own amps.
These musical experiments, which included adding a maracas player to the band, as well as bringing in female guitarists, helped create Bo Diddley's unique sound and image. In early 1955, Bo and his harmonica player, Billy Boy Arnold, had touted their demo around Chicago labels. Their first stop was a rival record label, VJ, right across the street from Chess.
Secretary was on her way to lunch, and she said, "What you guys want?" I said, "We got a dub." She said, "Let me hear it." She put the dub on and played 1 second and said, "I don't like that."
They thought it was junk, thought it was weird and different sounding. He walked across the street and played it for my uncle.
Phil Chess came out of the back room. He knew me. He said, "Hey, what you got, man? Got something for me?" I said, "Yeah." So he put it on there and he heard, "I'm a man."
And my uncle immediately knew, called my father in, and my father said, "Yeah." Boom. It was an instant hit.
When I was a little boy, about the age of five, I had something in my pocket. Keep a lot of folks alive. Now I'm a man. May 21. You better believe me, baby. We can have a lot of fun. I'm a man.
I spell M-A-N.
Although I'm a Man was a hit, the A-side, a song called Bo Diddley, recorded in the same session, was a bigger breakthrough. And with its tremolo guitar, hambone beat and maracas, it encapsulated Bo Diddley's innovative new sound.
Don't let it decide, baby, diamond ring. If that diamond ring don't shine, he gonna take it to a private eye.
He just seemed to try revolutionary sort of sounds, and that rhythm, the classic Bo Diddley rhythm, is entirely his.
Bo Diddley played the guitar like a drummer played the drums.
Make it pretty, baby, on Sunday cold.
He's like from some other place, you know? And you were kind of scared of it, and yet you wanted to embrace it.
Well, how many people in music can tell you that they created an entire sound?
In May 1955, just 2 months after Bo Diddley made his debut at Chess, a 29-year-old guitarist from St. Louis called Chuck Berry traveled to Chicago looking for a record deal. Here he met his hero, Muddy Waters, who suggested he approach Leonard Chess with his songs, one of which was called Ida Red.
And I show you how the genius of Leonard. Leonard didn't think that Ida Red was catchy enough. So he had Chuck to change it to Maybelline, which was, you know, that word, that name was better.
Maybelline was released in July 1955. 13-year-old Marshall Chess was traveling in a car with his father when they heard a white radio DJ play the song on a white radio station.
Maybelline,
Why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started doing the thing you used.
I remember the disc jockey was Howard Miller, the afternoon, 4 o'clock show. Boom, Maybelline, Chuck Berry goes on. My father got so excited, he turned to me and he said, Marshall, he said, we finally made it.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started back doing the thing you used to do. A Cadillac pulled up to 104, my phone got hot and wouldn't do no more. Cloud and started to rain. I tooted my horn for the passing lane. The rainwater blowing all under my hood. I knew that was doing my motor good. Maybelline, why can't you be true?
Chuck Berry crossed over into the white, and the white disc jockeys was playing the record. And that opened up a whole new field.
Welcome once again to the WCFL All Night Record Show. The time right now, about 7 minutes after 4 a.m.
Why can't you be true? Can't you be true?
The middle class had grown to where white kids had cars for the first time. Black kids did not have cars riding around. Chuck's genius was he understood that emerging white culture and wrote to them.
And there were lyrics that we could really relate to. And when he was singing about back in the USA and the hamburgers sizzling, etc., we'd only just about got hamburgers over here with Wimpy's. You just realised that there was another whole attitude to a hamburger, and you could smell this sizzling. You know, it was just he just painted these pictures. It was so lyrical, and you just knew as a teenager that there was something really going on over there.
New youth television shows like American Bandstand were also embracing the rock and roll phenomenon.
The importance of American Bandstand to Chess Records, or any record company at that time, was creating a hit record for you. It reached millions of homes that the small R&B stations did not reach.
Max Cooperstein was a good friend of Dick Clark, the host of American Bandstand. Max encouraged Dick to put Chuck Berry on his show.
Here he is, Mr. Chuck Berry. He got in Louisiana, close to New Orleans. Way back up in the woods among the evergreens. The student of a private native earth and wood. Where there's a country boy named Johnny Good. Who never ever learned to read or write so well. But he could play a guitar just like a ring in a bell. Go.
American Bandstand was one of the most watched music shows on U.S. television. Chess Records was now operating on a much bigger stage. The label was now crossing over into the white mainstream media, even teenage movies. The film Rock, Rock, Rock featured a number of Chess acts, including Chuck Berry and his latest hit, Roll Over Beethoven. This song perfectly captured the moment when rock and roll changed the world for good.
He's saying, you know, once it was classical music, you know, or once it was jazz, or once it was this, now it's this new thing called rock and roll, you know? And he was making that actually come true.
Roll over Beethoven, I gotta hear it again today.
Like the Chess blues artist before him, Chuck Berry would have a huge influence on the giants of 1960s rock music, especially the Rolling Stones.
The Rolling Stones are one of the inventors of rock music, the entire genre. And so when you pass on that influence through them, that goes through the entire history of rock music.
But in the middle of Chuck Berry's huge crossover success in the late 1950s, Chess Records almost shut down. In 1957, Leonard Chess had a heart attack.
He was frustrated that his career would be sidelined at this crucial moment of his life. And of course, he didn't stop really smoking, and he went right back to work. The whole family was horribly upset.
Just when Leonard, the label's driving force, should have been avoiding stress, there was another crisis for him to deal with. Chuck Berry, Chess's biggest selling artist, was accused of taking a 14-year-old waitress across state lines.
It was devastating for us when Chuck Berry got arrested with a federal crime called the Mann Act.
You got to help me. I can't do it all by myself.
We did everything we could to keep him from going to prison, but we failed. He went to prison.
I can't do it all by myself.
But the controversies for Chess Records didn't stop there. At the end of the 1950s, the label was under investigation when the payola scandal swept the record business. Payola meant giving backhanders to radio DJs to make certain records a hit.
Some of these jocks got crazy and they're buying big cars, big fur coats, and the Internal Revenue wanted to know where the money was coming from.
The majority of our payola were disc jockeys who got a salary check every month, and we did deduct the taxes. We didn't break the law because they were going after everyone on breaking tax laws because payola wasn't illegal. They let Chess off the hook.
At the end of the 1950s, despite this series of setbacks for the label, Leonard was determined to be at the forefront of the new style of music emerging from the black underground.
Oh, sometimes I get a good feeling, yeah. Yeah!
We really wanted to expand Chess. We were under the impression that the electric blues was dying out. The sales were dropping. They started buying soul music.
Some of the producers got smart and they started writing optimistic songs. You know, like I'm Gonna, and One Day Soon, and It's Gonna Happen. And they started writing things that you look forward to.
I don't want you to be no slave.
After the label's difficulties in the late 1950s, Soul's fresh new optimism spread to Chess Records itself. The label's next star would break the Chess mold. Rather than another male musician from the South, their new star was a young 21-year-old woman with attitude from California.
Etta James was one of the prettiest black girls that I had ever seen. Plus, she could sing.
And oh yeah! And oh yeah! And oh! And oh! And oh yeah now.
I think it was probably Something's Got a Hold on Me, the first thing that I heard. It was just a vocal that was just summed it all up. Everything was good, all this sort of blues and gospel.
She was top notch. Number one, just put it like that. Whenever she came in, everybody started moving.
In the recording studio, Leonard provoked Etta James every bit as much as his male blues musicians. And despite rumors, their relationship was purely platonic. Even so, it was still highly charged.
Leonard Chess never went with Etta James. There was never a relationship there other than musically and him trying to keep her straight. But he had a relationship with Etta where he could curse in the studio. And it would burn up Etta to the point to where she just really, really would start singing.
He had her crying and he ripped her contract up and anything to get the emotion out of her when she sang.
At last, my love has come along.
Out of this volatile relationship came some beautiful music. Leonard knew Etta was special and was more than willing to splash out on large orchestras when recording lush ballads, like the 1941 wartime classic, At Last.
That song came from Etta's deep down in her, an inner place that nobody else could reach, nobody else can reach, because it didn't come from her voice, it came from her soul.
my heart was wrapped up in clover. The night I looked at you.
Her maturity and her, you know, the scope of her talent was such that it didn't make any difference how old she was. She felt it, and she made you feel it.
A dream that I can call my own. I found a thrill to press my...
One thing that made Etta so prized at Chess was her musical diversity. At last, both the album and the single were big hits for Chess and helped change the label's public profile.
We were getting recognized by radio stations that we hadn't been getting airplay on with any of our artists. So it did open up a lot more avenues for us.
For you are mine at last.
In 1963, with Etta at the height of her powers, Leonard was still restless. With his eye on the future, he took another business gamble, spending $1 million buying a local Chicago radio station, which he renamed WVON, the voice of the Negro.
WVON, giant sound of soul.
We were the first big station with 24 hours of personalities and playing R&B and blues. Huge, big. Unbelievable.
You just had to lock into WVON. It was part of your everyday occurrence in terms of just dealing with life, period.
I mean, the thing that made WVON so special is that it took community issues and made them omnipresent, and then giving organizations time that they would never ever have.
By the summer of 1963, rather than serving a variety of Chicago's minority communities, Radio WVON now catered exclusively to the city's huge black population.
Somewhere dying, we need love.
Leonard and Phil understood that they found their first success in the black community. And while it may be a cliche to say, you know, we want to give back something, he did, but at the same time thought that there was nothing wrong with having a successful business enterprise.
WVON, the voice of the Negro. I'm Herb Kent, getting ready to jam like a big dog.
As the Chess empire in Chicago was growing, the fight for black American civil rights was heating up. Leonard was shocked at the images of racial violence coming out of the southern states.
When he saw the dogs and the hosing of Selma and the civil rights marches, he was really upset. He knew about the segregation. We were called nigger lovers many times by many white people across America.
In 1963, Marshall, now 21 years old, experienced this racism firsthand whilst recording the live album Bo Diddley's Beach Party in South Carolina.
I want everybody to keep up some noise. I want you to holler, I'm all right.
When Bo Diddley's black maracas player Jerome Green jumped into the white audience, all hell broke loose.
All of a sudden, the lights start flashing, in walked police with German Shepherd police dogs. Sound shuts off, concert's up, over. What's going on? Everyone is confused. Cops took me on the side, they threw me against the wall, said, Jew man, you think these niggers can dance here with white people? You got another thing coming. If you don't stop this, we're gonna lock you up and your people won't know where to find you for 2 weeks. We stopped the concert. Ended up having to go sit in my hotel room and listen to a honeymoon couple through the wall in the next room.
Well, let me do that number now that's shooting up the charts called Little Red Rooster.
I am the Little Red Rooster. Too lazy to crow for day.
following year, in 1964, the Rolling Stones, who Marshall Chess would later manage, became the latest sensation after the Beatles. Their early releases included numerous Chess covers, including a version of Howling Wolf's Little Red Rooster.
Keep everything in the farm, upset in every way.
They first became the Rolling Stones, they were a band. They were playing not quite the whole Chess repertoire, but, you know, maybe 90% of what they was doing.
The dogs begin to bark, hounds begin to howl.
Out of all the British invasion bands of the mid-1960s, it was the Rolling Stones who really turned white America onto the blues that Chess had released a decade earlier.
It's kind of blinding to the point where, you know, a bunch of guys from the UK got to introduce blues to America, because America, both black, which, you know, in the black radio and media circle says, oh, that's older people's music, I'm not trying to hear that no more. And white circles just being totally oblivious to black music.
The Rolling Stones' devotion to the music of Chess Records led them to the label Chicago Studio in 1964.
I picked up the phone and it was Andrew Oldham, the manager of the Rolling Stones, saying, we're coming to tour in America. We'd love to record at the Chess Studios. Now, in my mind is, these guys think that they're going to record in Chess Studios, it's going to sound like a Chess record. The reason Chess records sound the way they do is because of the artists, because of the way they're played. Of course, I have many memories of Willie Dixon and Muddy Waters coming to meet them and to try to hustle their songs to them. And the great Keith Richards story of saying he saw Muddy Waters painting the building, which is bullshit, which has been verified as bullshit over and over again.
It must have been extraordinary for those people to see these guys who were rock stars. Rock stars. And they had come to Chess Records on purpose to record.
The attention the Rolling Stones gave to Chess Records revitalized the careers of its blues acts. Chess artists like Howling Wolf, to their surprise, were now receiving invitations to perform on America's most popular programs, like The Ed Sullivan Show and Shindig.
It gave exposure to the Howling Wolves. No one knew of Howling Wolf. Mick Jagger talked about Howling Wolf. All of a sudden, people knew about Howling Wolf.
As white college kids of 1965 danced to Howling Wolf, the Chess empire continued to grow. The label was about to move into huge new premises with much larger overheads. They needed a massive hit to keep up the momentum. On the 2nd of September 1965, a recent Chess signing, the pianist and singer from St. Louis, Fontella Bass, was recording a song at Chess.
I was at the studio when she recorded Rescue Me, and Leonard and I stood up and gave each other five. Now, Leonard was too square to give somebody five, but he gave me five that day, and we both said, that's a hit.
Leonard had his hit. Rescue Me was one of the label's biggest ever singles, reaching number one on the Billboard R&B charts and selling over a million copies. This was a boom time for Chess. Their new huge eight-story complex also housed a pressing plant and recording studios. The business was growing, their soul artists were climbing the charts, and their jazz line was releasing big sellers like Ramsey Lewis's album, The In Crowd. Leonard was thrilled with the continuing popularity of his jazz and soul artists.
Something deep down in my soul.
Even his favorite diva, Etta James, whose career had dipped since her early 60s triumphs, was back recording classics like Tell Mama and I'd Rather Go Blind. But despite this success in the jazz and soul genres, Leonard wished his old blues musicians were sharing similar sales figures.
No, I'm still in his heart a blues man, you know? I could see a tear in his eye when his guys, Muddy and all these guys, were sort of waning in popularity, you know?
In fact, Leonard was now devoting more and more time to Radio WVON and handing his son greater responsibilities and creative influence at the label. Marshall, now in his mid-20s, was embracing the new psychedelic movement sweeping the States, and he believed that Charles Stepney, a classically trained arranger at the label, had the potential to radically expand the musical language of Chess in this strange new era.
Charles Stepney, to me, was my musical idol. Oh, boy. Did he blow our minds.
His whole being was music. He wasn't just a musician. He was music.
One of Marshall's plans with Charles Stepney was to introduce Muddy Waters to the hippie masses with the album Electric Mud.
I don't want you to be no slave.
I used Muddy Waters like a movie director would use Marlon Brando. I needed a lead character who was a star.
And we told Muddy we're going to do, you know, a high-energy album, hard rock. And Muddy is scratching his head. He don't know, how the hell is this going to be? I don't know, man. I mean, he really couldn't fathom the idea of what the hell we were going to be taking him out of his orbit. We said, no, Muddy, all you got to do is sing exactly what you've been singing. What we'll do is change the arrangements.
Want to make love to you, love to you, love to you.
Although Electric Mud was criticized by music journalists on its release, the album was one of Muddy's biggest sellers ever and became a cult album.
We really need to listen to it a few times to see how they'd arrived at these things. It wasn't designed to be a sort of paperback version of an album.
Finding out that the approach was being panned at that particular day, at that day by purists, made me gravitate to it even more and even dig the attempt even more.
But Marshall and Charles Stepney's work with the Rotary Connection caught the spirit of the times far more successfully.
I wanted to do an interracial, soft music, psychedelic album. And the concept was, if you're having a bad trip on LSD or mushrooms, which was sweeping America at the time, put the headphones on with Rotary Connection, it's going to bring you down.
On the Rotary Connection's debut album, Charles Stepney blended the sounds of violins, French horns and sitars into a psychedelic landscape.
It wasn't just that he was classically gifted and a tremendous musician and also able to play jazz and rhythm and blues, but he was able to lift everybody up to a whole new level. It was beautiful.
It exploded. I think it sold 25,000 in the first week in Chicago. We never had a record like that.
Although the Rotary Connection's debut album was a big hit in the Midwest, Charles Stepney's work would come to national attention when he applied his innovative approach to the more traditional soul sound of the Chess Records vocal group, The Dells.
He would make us musically bow down to whatever it was that he had in his mind. We respected him so much, and he respected us.
The Dells became the biggest sellers on the label in the late 1960s. Chess Records, which started out in 1950 as a specialist label in Chicago, was now a mighty independent corporation. But America was on fire at the end of that decade, and Leonard Chess decided it was time to take one of the biggest gambles of his life. In April 1968, Martin Luther King was assassinated and Black America exploded.
I got up the following morning and I got to the freeway and the entire, all the farms, all the side of the freeway looked like army camp. And then all the tanks and armored cars and so forth came rolling down Michigan Avenue.
Just months later, the Chicago Democratic Convention ended in riots. During these tumultuous times, Chess Records itself became a target.
There was a lot of pressure being put on Leonard from the black militants because of the white man owning the label, and they thought that the white man was making all the money.
They did put pressure on Chess Records.
This was all too much for Leonard. With ambitious plans already laid to break into the emerging black television market, Leonard decided to sell the record label he had spent two decades building. But his television ambitions were never realized. On the 16th of October, 1969, whilst driving to his radio station, WVON, Leonard, aged 52, had another heart attack. This time, it was fatal.
It was a big shock to everyone at Chess. The whole company was... I went there 2 days after he died. Everyone saw me and broke into tears. I broke into tears.
I cried my eyeballs out. I lost the best friend I ever had. One of the best friends I ever had.
At the funeral 4 days later, Muddy Waters wept at Leonard's graveside. Muddy expressed the loss he felt on Leonard's radio station, WVON.
Muddy Waters?
Right.
Yes, how are you?
Oh, not too good since I got bad news. We got acquainted in 1946.
Mm-hmm.
So we were pretty close all the way down through the years. So I think he would say what I'm saying now. He made me and I made him.
Mm-hmm.
I like to say I lose a good friend.
Yes, Muddy Waters, we've all lost a good friend.
Didn't want to have to do it. Didn't want to have to be the one to say it.
Under the label's new owners, GRT, General Recorded Tape, Marshall was made president and hated it.
They bought a creative machine and didn't even realize it. They stifled the creativity of Chess.
I saw the record company destroyed in whatever time it was that Leonard passed.
In 1970, a disillusioned Marshall Chess left the label to manage Britain's most famous Chess fans, the Rolling Stones. Phil Chess continued to work in radio broadcasting. The label itself limped on under the control of GRT until 1975, when it was sold again. The glory days of Chess Records were over.
There's a spirit in that music produced from that time that has not only musical but historical significance.
I could think of Chess as being possibly a contender for the greatest record label of all time.
That sort of coming together of cultures always creates something interesting. It really does. And certainly it did in this case.
So great was the label's musical and historical significance that when the Voyager space rocket was launched in 1977, the time capsule it was carrying included a Chess classic. Alongside the works of Beethoven, Bach, and Mozart, it was Chuck Berry's Johnny B. Goode.
My children, unfortunately, never got to meet their grandfather. But I said, kids, can you believe this? Your grandfather produced a record sent out to outer space. I said, what could be better than that? An immigrant from Poland coming to America and ending up making a record that's representing humanity.